Hello, everyone. Good to see you or read your name. And I think we can get started in the interest of all of us. It was a very interesting idea to get, which came up in different meetings, was developed that we could talk while we're in lockdown about scientific books which have been inspiring for us. And we were looking into let's see. So good. Into books which we found inspiring, which people might be interested in reading. For this reason, I said, yeah, there's one book which I found really interesting, which was The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, because it made me think about is toxicology, the area I'm active in, actually undergoing a revolution or not? Or is it only the normal evolution in science we are observing here? I put up here a QR code for those of you who would like to have the slides, but you can also shoot me an email. I've lodged them here. I warn you, they're about 100 megabyte. I don't know why some of the pictures seem to be rather big. I will also later have some QR codes for some of the papers you might be interested in downloading. So keep your telephone close if you want to take a picture and follow these links. But I'm also very happy to send you any of the material I'm mentioning in my presentation. Okay, that's me. Saving More Than Animals was actually an article in the Scientific American, which I wrote with my predecessor, Alan Goldberg, in 2005. And I was still working for the European Commission. I like this motto, so we just printed actual masks for our staff and board members with a logo of our Center for Alternatives to Animal Testing, which is the oldest center in the school, 39 years already. And we are, or I am at least, a physician in the School of Public Health. We are trying to work to overcome animal testing, but in the interest of public health and of patients and consumers. Yeah? That's a very important point. Our team is normally not very good in social distancing, but we have to, as everybody has at the moment. I'm showing them because, as always, when I'm referring to any of our work, this has been done by our people on the team, and I might not give them sufficient credit when I'm talking. Our center is for 10 years now a transatlantic organization. We have formerly a joint venture between Hopkins and the University of Konstanz in Germany. So we are present on both sides of the Atlantic and mirror some of our activities. And today, I'm not going to talk directly about our work, so I will illustrate some things with this, but it is really about how does science actually work? Because that's the interesting question, which was posed in 1962 by Thomas Kuhn. And he reflected on, is the progress of science actually a revolutionary process or not? You might know that scientific revolution and the Enlightenment is something which is very closely linked. The French Revolution and other movements some 200 years ago came about as a consequence of scientific developments which were impacting on society, which put upside down also the political structures. For those of you interested more into these aspects, I recommend very much another book, which is Enlightenment Now by Steven Pinker. I think it's very refreshing because he is not the typical critics of everything gets worse, but somebody who says science is still delivering and we can't do better and we do much better because we have scientific revolutions continuing to go on. Okay, but the book to discuss today was written in 1962 by Thomas Samuel Kuhn. He passed away in 1996. He is still one of the most cited philosophers of science. His book was really a big hit because it was really talking about some of the fundamentals of how does science work and when does it not work as efficient, as fast as we would like to see it. His book has a number of chapters. But before coming to this, I would like to alert you, there is this very interesting abrogated version, which was done by Pallares. He is giving a few page summary of the entire book, which is very, very much condensed, but it is a way of really getting the ideas of the book on a silver platter. Yeah? So here's the link to his summary. Okay, so he really starts off with historical thoughts about revolution and scientific revolutions, and then how does science actually work, and then many aspects of the revolutionary process. I will come back to many of these aspects later. In the end, he's talking about revolutions and paradigm shifts in more or less one sentence, because he's saying in science, revolutions often occur as paradigm shifts, and we don't see them or recognize them as revolutions because there are additions to the scientific knowledge. And for the student of a given science, everything is presented as a history of science, as there was a, let's say, continuation of old ideas moving gradually to new ones, and we are not really sensing anymore that there were moments of radical change in almost every science where these revolutionary paradigm shifts actually took place. The main idea of Kuhn is that there is a scientific revolution cycle. It is a cycle where science matures, so starting from the very left, from the immature science aspect, moving to a normal science, something which we consider the science we are working in, as that's our worldview, until suddenly this science encounters problems, anomalies, as he calls them, where evidently the science is not delivering, that there's problems we cannot solve with the current paradigm we are following. And if these anomalies are accumulating or are getting big enough, this moves the field into crisis. A crisis where we doubt the tools and the concepts we have been pursuing for a while. And this is then the moment where we move into a revolutionary change. That's not a new idea. Nothing is new under the sun. I found, for example, here this Swami Vivekananda, who obviously lived long before Kuhn, and he said here, all human activities likewise progress in waves, art, literature, science, and religion. So the basic idea is nothing new. It's waves of development. It's not continuous development, but it is something which is underlying the progress in science. But what Kuhn really did, he fully thought the idea through. The idea of science progressing in these cycles of being generally agreed, moving into doubt, moving into crisis, and moving into revolutionary change. And I would like to translate the book for you to my field of interest, one of the pillars of our department in school, which is toxicology, the safety sciences. A science which has long been established as an animal science, where we inject or feed animals with certain substances, and then as a consequence, we are testing the effects these substances have. If you look into toxicology, it is definitely not a revolutionary change we are observing. There has not been a revolution in quite a while. The toxicology, which we are having today, has actually developed usually around scandals. Every scandal gives a patch. We see that there's a certain problem with a certain class of substances, a certain health effect, and then we try to avoid this health effect for the future. And many of these patches are really old. Acute toxicity testing dates back to the 20s. The more chronic tests to the 30s, eye irritation, skin irritation, assays from the 40s, the reproductive toxicity in the 60s. And one of the younger ones is actually the cancer bioassay from 1970. These were essays which were introduced when I was not yet born or in kindergarten. And that's very unusual in science. And we don't really have ways of removing such a patch, to remove them by some more modern science. I've been very much in the business of alternatives to these animal experiments and validation. But if we take the 10,000 foot perspective, the big numbers of assays and the big numbers of animals we have not been replacing. And each and every patch is reflecting more the time of when it was created. It was the 20s when mice and rats started to enter the laboratories. And this is the time point when problems were solved for many of these toxicity tests and where they used, because this was hip. Like stem cells are hip nowadays, probably nowadays we would solve a problem with a stem cell-based assay. This is the paper I am referring to in this lecture quite a bit, which I wrote in 2008. It was an invited lecture from FRAME, a UK organization on laboratory animal welfare. Again, I have put a QR code here, which you can use to download the paper or happy to send it. I was asking here, really, is our science progressing in waves or not? Is it continuously developing? And I applied the thinking of Thomas Kuhn. I would like to go through with you through this, but also then applying some now more updated examples than I had in this text and move it then to the next phase. So one of the key principles of Thomas Kuhn is that he says, a scientific community cannot practice its trade without some set of received beliefs. So I was wondering, what we toxicologists do believe? And these are some, let's say it's a bit of a brainstorming list. It's not really comprehensive in no way, but we have some ideas like chemicals are bad. Yeah? There's a general belief that chemicals are something to be avoided. At least this is the perception also of a general public out of our work. Is this really the case? And this is something which came to me as a big surprise when I was really looking into the numbers over the years.
So Thomas, can I interrupt?
Please go.
In the previous slide, one of the items I saw was how if in doubt, use the precautionary principle.
I come back to this point. I go through all of these points now.
Okay.
Perhaps we can discuss then, yeah?
Yes, okay.
Okay. So the as you can see here, if you check the numbers in some databases, it is quite surprising. Using the typical cutoff of 2 grams per kilogram, 90% of the chemicals in use are not killing mice or rats. 90%, you can ingest as a rat or mouse, as a rodent, you can ingest 2 grams per kilogram. Imagine for a human being, this is 150 to 300 grams of this substance. that's a lot of stuff, yeah? And you see the other numbers, yeah? Only 3% are skin corrosive. So most chemicals are really not exerting hazards as we have classified them. And this has enormous consequences because most of the tools we're having are only made for identifying the bad chemicals, while we actually would need some to identify the good ones. I will come back to this because this has enormous statistical implications. Second is our strong belief that animals can reflect what we are doing, with respect also to what happens to the chemicals, how they distribute, are metabolized, the defense mechanisms and others. I've been collecting information on this for the last 20 years and also contributed to the literature here because actually toxicology should have the best animal tests possible. Ours are standardized tests. As you saw earlier, they are enshrined into guidelines sometimes for many, many decades. We have a quality assurance system, good laboratory practice for the regulatory part of toxicology, which no other part of science enjoys. You have skilled performers because GLP prescribes you cannot have somebody who is learning carrying out a test. The people have to show that they're already proficient. You take big doses. You don't need, like a pharmacologist does, a disease model on top. You just test pure substance effects at maximum tolerated doses. Yeah. We created some databases, and we found sometimes an enormous repetition of tests. There's, for example, this DRACE rapid eye test, which is a very infamous test, but a standard assay in toxicology. In our own database, which we created in 2016, we found that each and every chemical was tested about 3 times. We found 2 chemicals which were tested more than 90 times in this assay, and 69 were tested more than 45 times. And this enormous waste of animals actually gave us the opportunity to ask, how reproducible is such an assay? What did we see? We took 600 chemicals which were in the first test corrosive and asked what happened in the second test in a simulation. And we saw that only in 70% it would be again corrosive, in 20% it was mild, and in 10% it had no effect. So this challenges a lot the reproducibility of these assays. We did so for 6 of the most frequent toxicological tests, the infamous 6-pack, including acute toxicities, mutagenicity, 28-day studies, skin sensation, and others. And we found up to 750 chemicals which were tested more than twice. And on average, these 6 assays were 81% reproducible. And if you looked for the toxic chemicals, they were actually only 69% reproducible, because a non-toxic is non-toxic, non-toxic, while the toxic sometimes don't show the effect. So this was published in 2018. And there's increasing awareness about these limitations, also for the more chronic assays, the systemic health effects. Mice and rats predict each other on average 60% of the time. If you look into chronic toxicity, if you look into cancer, reproductive toxicity, this is one of our papers where we summarized some of these data. This was an interesting study done by Wang and Gray. They took data from the National Toxicology Program. They looked into 37 chemicals which went into cancer assays. And these cancer assays, interesting, they did not look into the cancer. They looked into the non-cancer endpoints, which were also recorded in these lifetime exposures of these animals. And they compared them to what we did know about the chemicals from earlier studies. So non-carcinogenic endpoints, 37 chemicals. They had both mice and rats, male and female, and they compared to earlier study, historical studies available. And then they asked, what are the correlations? And to make a long story short, there was no correlation at all. So neither between the genders, nor between mice and rats, nor between the findings in the NTP study to the historical studies, which is putting a very, very bad light on these type of studies. Another study which I like to show is the bioavailability of drugs, which means how much of a substance given orally to rodents, dogs, primates, or to humans is showing up. And what you can see here is not the sky of stars over Baltimore. It is the lack of correlation between different animal species and humans. So how can you possibly do a quantitative risk assessment when already how much goes from the intestine into the circulation is so different between our experimental species and humans? There's more concern, and again, this is a paper for those of you interested looking into more. They are followed up on the predictive value of animal tests. What is the preclinical work telling us? And I'm showing this slide here also because there were 2 studies which prompted this paper, done by 2 pharmaceutical companies. One in 2011 showed that Bayer was able to reproduce the mostly animal studies, which led them to for to consider certain development projects for their in their pharmaceutical development, they were able to reproduce only 20 to 25% of academic research. And Amgen had a study which was focusing on 53 cancer studies, which were considered hallmark papers, so very important key papers, all of them animal studies, and they were only 11% reproducible when they went into this. These two papers have stirred up a lot of discussion. There's been follow-up, but it shows very clearly that especially academic research in animals is not very reproducible, and this is a starting point of the so-called reproducibility crisis and a lot of efforts at the NIH at the moment. So we might actually really overestimate how we are doing toxicology at the moment. In the paper from 2008 on Thomas Kuhn, I wrote, it is tempting to interpret some of our procedures as rituals where animals are sacrificed to receive the blessing of the gods against the demons of chemicals which otherwise haunt us. That's a bit provocative, but I like to be provocative in these writings. But it is really very difficult to see how this is actually creating a scientific sound basis for protecting us. One key problem here is that we are doing experiments, how we can do them cheaply and quickly, which is high dose, short-term experiments. But the actual problems we are having are low dose and long-term effects. So what you see here is the animal, the rat, high dose acute testing, that's where we are testing. And what we would need to know is low dose chronic, but here we cannot afford actually to test. We would need far too many animals, but we say here, trust me, I'm a toxicologist. I would say the t-shirt might have to read, you may say I am a dreamer. Because there is no solid basis for assuming that the same type of pathophysiology is taking place in these two conditions. And we have not really a lot of substantiating work which would actually show us this. Yeah, we do not need statistics. That's, again, a very provocative way of saying it. We're not good in statistics anyway. One of the best studies of all was this meta-analysis from Altman, who showed that using 1,667 papers in total, only 37% of them had proper statistics. My personal impression is there's not very much changing since then, but nobody has taken effort, at least I could not identify one, to assess statistics. Many toxicology guidelines do not even foresee statistics. If you think a paper, a scientific paper or a study of a substance typically depends not on one experiment, but if we assume that each experiment is done with a 5% error mark and the overall conclusion depends on them, you see how the overall probability of being correct drops if we apply the 5% error for each of the experiments. So there's good reason why a lot of this is not correct. This is another one, a thinking which we applied in this article from 2005. We called it diagnosis toxic. If you see that in the end, toxicity testing is a diagnostic process. You apply some tests, then you say, yeah, not you have cancer, but you produced cancer, your chemical. This was a calculation which showed if you do an HIV test on somebody without any risk factors or symptoms, the probability of the person being infected without knowing is about 1 in 10,000. And if the test is 99.9% accurate and positive, the actual probability of somebody having HIV is only 9%. Because if you test 10,000, you will find this one real positive, but you have 10 false positives with this almost perfect assay. The interesting is that we can translate, and this is called the positive predictive value, and there's a negative predictive value. So can I trust a positive result? Can I trust the negative result? You can simply calculate these of prevalences. And you see here, as you saw earlier, most of these prevalences are in the 1 to 10 to maximum 20% range. This is a bit the different prevalences here. Our assays, however, are not as good as the HIV tests. We're only having 70 to 95% predictive assays, or accurate assays in this case. What you can see is that's how much you can trust the positive finding. So we populate necessarily our databases with a lot of chemicals which don't have the property we are testing for. And we can, on the contrary, rely very much on the negative ones. As you can see here, even these imperfect assays are almost right at these prevalences of toxicity. Again, I invite you to read the paper if you're interested in more of the thinking. And I'm at the moment writing actually a paper on COVID diagnostics and applying the same type of thinking here. Okay, pure exposure information does not matter. I'm happy to disagree on this. I believe, on the contrary, that exposure is neglected and we have to move towards exposure-driven risk assessment. I cannot talk to this very much, but I would like just to alert you that our department has started an exposome collaborative fall last year. And we described, together with some of our guest authors, the speakers of the symposium, we wrote this article on the exposome. So there is something happening, I think, which is also turning upside down how toxicology is being done. If in doubt, be precautionary. That's one of the mantras, especially in Europe, where precautionary principles are hailed. This is a breakfast, obviously a European one. You have some sparkling wine here. I need the wine later. We protect it, for example, against dioxin, TCDD in the eggs. If we apply the very same calculation which delivered the threshold for TCDD to the alcohol in this glass of sparkling wine, we can still drink sparkling wine, exactly one glass in 345 years. That's the same calculation we applied for dioxin, and we're happy to very often throw away millions of eggs because a TCDD threshold has been broken. If you apply our standard assays, salt is in some assays genotoxic. So is sugar. Because we're testing in many guidelines up to 10 millimolar, where these unspecific genotoxic results are obtained. We're protected against minute amounts of pesticides on the cucumbers here, for example. At the same time, these plants have natural pesticides at 10,000 times higher concentrations. And of these, 63 went into cancer bioassays and 35 of them tested positive. And so were 23 of 31 ingredients of coffee carcinogenic in the bioassay when tested in rats. So if coffee was not a natural product, you could not add it to food because of the Delaney Clause in the US. And this is just all to illustrate how precautionary, or from my feeling, over precautionary we often are establishing certain safety clauses. To show it the other way around, that's aspirin. Aspirin is the oldest chemical drug on the market. In 1897, Felix Hoffmann did synthesize this. If we would run aspirin to the battery of tests today, we would have to label it as harmful if swallowed, because its LD50 is 150 to 200 milligram per kilogram in rats, which is interestingly the maximum allowed daily dose in patients. So we are treating our patients with doses which kill 50% of the rats. No safety factor of 100, which we typically require nowadays. It's an irritant to the eye, to the respiratory tract, to the skin. Good news, it's not carcinogenic. But it's a co-carcinogen promoting the carcinogenic effect of others, has unclear mutagenicity findings, and it produces embryonic malformations in essentially every animal species tested. Not in humans. 89,000 pregnancies were tested. There's no evidence for aspirin producing malformations in human embryos. But you could say it would be very unlikely to bring aspirin to the market nowadays. And this is just as an illustration of the precautionary principle. So how comes that so many of our essays are producing false positive results. This is a study which on the first hand has nothing to do with toxicology. But I love the study. These were the 10 million residents of Ontario, 18 to 100 years old in the year 2000. And they were randomly assigned to first two groups of 5 million each. And then they checked their different astrological zodiac symbols. And they asked, is there any correlation between certain zodiac symbols and diagnosis of those which were hospitalized? They found 24 associations in the first 5 million, which were clearly significant. And when testing these 24 in the second 5 million patient set, Leo was prone to gastrointestinal hemorrhage and Sagittarians to humerus fractures with very good controlled experiments. They controlled for multiple testing. The statistics are without flaw. And their conclusion was, testing of multiple non-pre-specified hypotheses increases the likelihood of detecting implausible associations. Because the problem here is that they tested 223 different diagnoses. And then even with proper statistics, some things get random results. What does it have to do with toxicology? We don't test 223 diagnoses, but a 28-day study in rats has 40 endpoints, a cancer bioassay 60, and the two-generation study for reproductive toxicity 80 endpoints. And we don't have group sizes of 5 million, and we don't control for multiple testing. So you can imagine how much positive, false positives you are accumulating with these many things to be tested. Last point here, whatever the uncertainty was at the time of risk assessment, we can stop worrying afterward. No, we can't. And we can simply look into the drugs which made it through the most sincere toxicological assessments, or the substance which is drugs, next to pesticides. We're spending 5 million for one drug for toxicological tests. It's a big process, costs billions, a lot of them fail. But interestingly, after this, after testing in humans, still 1 in 100 patients dies in hospitals from adverse drug reactions. And 178 drugs had to be taken from the market, which is about 8% of what comes to the market because of toxicological side effects. So this is showing you that even human testing after all of the battery of animal testing is not protecting us sufficiently against toxic side effects. Okay, second point Kuhn makes is the nature of the rigorous and rigid preparation helps ensure that the received belief exerts a deep hold on the student's mind. I thought this resonates very nicely with this head of FDA from the 50s who said, "You too can become a toxicologist in two easy lessons each of 10 years." That's the rigorous and rigid preparation. You certainly will get some of this in with us too. So let's think about this for a moment. It is really instilling a feeling of you need the experience to exert the art of toxicology. This creates this comfort zone of regulators. This creates this, we have always done it of it, the base set of tests, which we cannot really change, the minimum information requirements, which all tell you in the end, you have to do it as we have always done it. This is part of the communication, how the younger toxicologists are introduced into the field. And this creates enormous resistance in the field. I love this book. Another classic, Follies and Fallacies in Medicine by Peter Skribernik and James McCormick. It's old, but it's available for free. The PDF can be found here. That's my favorite quote. And it says, learning from experience may be nothing more than learning to make the same mistakes with increasing confidence. And this is the idea behind what Thomas Kuhn is saying. We are believing we cannot change because there's a fear of change in scientists. The normal science is predicated on the assumption that the scientific community knows what the world is like. And scientists take great pains to defend that assumption. To this end, normal science often suppresses fundamental novelties because they are necessarily subversive of its basic commitments. You see, he is very clear about science is not willing to change easily. And I would like to illustrate this together with his fourth thought here. Research is a strenuous and devoted attempt to force nature into the conceptual boxes supplied by professional education. So what we teach our students is what we and them jointly try to force into our worldview. And I would like to take the example here from Contagan thalidomide. I was born around this age. Two of my classmates had these terrible malformations, and it was pure luck that my mom was not given this drug, which was considered absolutely safe at the time I was born. And I have to bring this now in the context of one of the biggest toxicological programs of all time, which is the European REACH legislation. The European REACH legislation, and I was very proud to be part of this when I was working for the European Commission, came from the problem that we have a lot of chemicals. You see here in 2006, they counted 80 million substances, synthesized 140,000 in commerce, and very few of them were actually tested and approved. And add to this mixtures, natural products, and metabolites. Yeah? Less than 10% actually had any type of data. And this is why Europe acted first in 2006. And as I said, I was part of this. But I also became a critic of the whole exercise. This is a very prominent paper from 2009, which I wrote, which got a lot of response on the European side because they did not like the critical view on this. And what we showed in this paper was that the big problem of REACH as it was constructed was reproductive toxicity. So exactly the response to the thalidomide disaster. About 70% of all costs of this program, which is several billion dollar of testing costs, and about 90% of all animal use is going into reproductive toxicity testing. So this was really singled out by this legislation as the big problem. So, and in fact, it has become the big problem. This is a paper of earlier this year. This paper, we showed how things have developed. And quite interestingly, this statistic by the EU did hide exactly some of these increases. More than 5 million additional animals were pups of these reproductive toxicity tests, which were not counted in the statistics, despite the fact that they fall under the European animal welfare legislation. So our predictions were right on spot with the number of animals this would consume, which was heavily argued against when we published in 2009 our Nature article. Okay, and what is the quality of the data we get? Let's assume reproductive toxicity means to find the black sheep among white sheep of chemicals, so the bad guys. So what are you doing? Here we have 25 white sheep and 25 black sheep, and we are applying now some testing. And reproductive toxicity, we know very well that mice and rats, rats and rabbits, rabbits and hamsters, they all predict each other by about 60%. So if you ask now, any of these species will predict humans similarly, yeah? We test first in rats. We will find 60% of the first in these rats of the black sheep. Not enough. For this reason, a second species is required. And we will identify if these are independent, 6 of the 10 remaining, which means we find a substantial part of this. The problem, however, is that only a very small portion of industrial chemicals is actually reproductive toxicants producing malformations. It is only 2 to 3% of the chemicals which are disturbing reproductive processes and the embryonic development. So in 1,000 sheep here, you have 25 representing these. And if we now apply our tests again, we'll find the 60% in reds on the expense of 40% false positives. And if we have a second species, we'll now find 84%. And you see, on the expense of 64% false positives. And this was another Nature paper in the same year where I demonstrated this and also showed from some databases that actually in this rank order, chemical substances were testing positive in these type of assays. And it's quite interesting. This is a letter which I received from a colleague from Procter & Gamble because he thought this was resonating with some of the things I was describing here. This is from 1966. When in response to the thalidomide disaster, the FDA did introduce these two generation assays. And the interesting part is on the next page here. It reads, it must be realized that even these improved guidelines reflect merely the state of the art at the present time, and undoubtedly further modifications will be needed in the future as additional knowledge in this area is developed. And exactly this has never happened in the more than 50 years since. Today, we believe that this is a pillar of our chemical safety that we cannot drop. And for this reason, this big expense in the respective legislation in Europe. So we are learning to make the same mistakes with increasing confidence. That's experience. I will drop the next three slides, but not without telling you an article, a book which I found really inspiring in this context is from Nassim Taleb, The Black Swan, where he also talks about these rare events and the consequences of the prediction error we are having. I've discussed this on these slides. You can read the slides, but I think we don't have the time to discuss this all. Okay, a shift, next Kuhn, a shift in professional commitments to shared assumption takes place when an anomaly subverts the existing tradition of scientific practice. These shifts are what Kuhn describes as scientific revolutions, the tradition shattering complements to the tradition bound activity of normal science. So we need something which demonstrates that our current paradigms are not adequate. And I'm listing here a few. I included one which I did not have obviously in the paper from at the time, which is COVID-19. So the 2020 disruption, which I will quickly touch on. But let's talk about them again, one by one. The effort of REACH. It was enormously important to understand what it takes to assess the enormous number of chemicals we do have. We, in the meantime, up to 160 million synthesized chemicals, 1,000 come to the US market per year. That's the number of pre-marketing notifications. So it's really a very dynamic field. And earlier, before REACH, we said 3% are extensively tested, the drugs and pesticides, and 10% are tested at all. After REACH, we actually are achieving 8% extensively testing and 16% tested at all. You see, there is still enormous toxicological ignorance, and most things come to the US market without proper testing. And the reason is simple, the prices. You see here what OECD guideline tests do cost in a contract research lab. Prices are in euros, so add some 10-15% for the dollar prices. And you can see that some of them are really ranking to some $800,000 easily, the carcinogenicity assay and so on. Yeah. Interestingly, a paper from February this year showed that the number of chemicals on the market seems to be much bigger. They brought together 22 chemical inventories from 19 countries, and they found in total 350,000 chemicals and mixtures of chemicals, which were listed here as in commerce. So there might be many more chemicals than the 140,000 we always assumed. And as interestingly, more than 50,000 are considered confidential chemicals or are ambiguously described up to 70,000. So the toxicological ignorance is really enormous. Let me quickly go through, jump over this. The second reason why the industry is a bit shaken up is a change in the profile of drugs which enter the market. More than 50% of drugs today are actually so-called biologicals, which means recombinant proteins of humans or antibodies against human structures, and all our traditional animal testing simply does not work. So we don't need to go into this into details, but the idea is clear. We have new products which don't fit into our traditional paradigm. So we need a revolution. The drying out of the pharmaceutical pipeline is another aspect. And here is one of the nice representations of this. You see here how much drugs do you get if you inflation corrected spend $1 billion. And you can see here how this has declined 80-fold since 1950 to 2010. So pharmaceutical companies spend more and more money to get less and less drugs. That's what is described in this graph. And this is a continuous process, which is worrying because the business model of drugs does not seem to work. These are market forces already, but there's more market forces. Again, a paper from 2018, we summarized the most important omics is economics. Quite interestingly, there is in the meantime an industry around alternatives to animal testing, and even in toxicology, this is far bigger than the animal market. You see 4.2 billion spent on animal tests per year, but 14.4 spent on cell culture type of toxicity. So there is market force. There's lots of companies, tons of companies pushing for these new tests. We see that the pharmaceutical industry is changing. There's not many figures, but these figures from the EU were really interesting. In 6 years only, from 2005 to 2011, while increasing their research spending, they dropped animal testing by 40%. Yeah, so this is the only spotlight I have, but it is in line with the overall perception that they use more and more in vitro and in silico tools beside this. Another example that we are simply not holding pace with product development is e-cigarettes, a topic I've been interested in for a while. There is more than 7,000 flavors in e-cigarettes on the market, and essentially nothing has been tested. And imagine 7,000 flavors going through a pipeline of thorough evaluation. So if you're interested in more economic aspects, here's the paper, happy to send. Then science is shaking up also sometimes by policymakers. And one of these is the European cosmetics legislation. In 2002, the European Parliament did decide that with a phase out until 2013, all animal testing of ingredients and final products has to end on cosmetics. And this has followed. You see in purple the countries who have now established some bans of animal testing. And you see also the polls of people supporting these type of bans in other parts of the world. And so they are following, sometimes in individual federal states, sometimes they are following country by country. Globalization is another challenge to an anomaly, as Thomas Kuhn would say. There's a lot of drivers of globalization, global markets, the rapidly developing emerging economies, mixing up things and taking over contract research testing, the communication technologies, we are sharing a lot of knowledge, and you cannot regulate a product in one country and not in another without the people saying, but why is it safe for us? We have again developed some ideas around the idea of globalization and its impact on alternative methods in a paper a bit ago. A new factor, which is, I think, interesting to see as an anomaly now, and I think we will soon recognize this as an anomaly, is COVID-19. You all know about the medical challenge now to develop drugs and vaccines, but fast, please. The numbers are incredible. We have more than 20,000 scientific papers already on COVID-19. I checked 23rd of June, we had 3,500 listed clinical studies, 2,169 of them being interventional studies, which were already running on 23rd of June. We had in April already 115 vaccines. The latest count last week was more than 160 candidate vaccines which are being tested. So we really are seeing an acceleration of clinical research which is unprecedented. And in this context, again, alternative methods, alternatives to animal testing play an important role. And this is an article which is available online and open access, which is describing how these new models are now helping with drug repurposing, target discovery, and so on in quality assurance. And I think the important take-home message here is this is an anomaly, one which shows we cannot test in a traditional way where it costs 5 million in animal studies before you can have a drug licensed, which takes you several years to run these assays, which are of questionable human relevance, where you need 20 kilograms of the substance to test in chronic studies. This is all not possible for things which are not yet on the market. And now suddenly the crisis is a door opener for thinking and allowing these new methodologies. And I think this will on the long term also change how we are accepting the new methodologies, because if it's working here, why not in other areas? So my paper in 2008 largely described the crisis situation, the anomaly and the resulting starting crisis of this. Now, 12 years later, I think we really are moving towards the revolutionary phase. And so this is not covered in the 2008 paper, but what has happened since is really the 2007 National Academy of Science report, Toxicity Testing the 21st Century, Vision and a Strategy, was really a starting point for a lot of change. And we've seen over the last decade or so, a lot of mechanistic toxicology and evidence-based approaches and others which are shaping how toxicology is working. And I see this as a revolutionary change. In 2009, when I started in Hopkins, I wrote this article, Mapping the Road Ahead. And we have actually worked ourselves very much along this line of challenges set up in 2009. So what is in it? To move from the old to the new toxicology, the revolution, we need systematic reviews, meta-analysis, risk of bias, so the evidence-based approaches, which we pursue with the evidence-based toxicology collaboration. We are leading the secretariat worldwide for this. And I have the first chair for evidence-based toxicology. Then there's a lot of technological developments, the various omics, the high content imaging, the high throughput screening, a lot of bioinformatics and bioengineering, so technological solutions which were not available in the 20th century. A very important part of this is organotypic cultures, humans on chip, organs on chip, trying to reproduce with stem cell technologies and others, organ functionalities. Our own work on mini brains is an example here. A lot of mechanistic toxicology, now it's usually called adverse outcome pathways. I still like to call them pathways of toxicity, but AOP is the more common term in the meantime. And it's about integrated testing strategies, combining many of these tools into a strategy. And this altogether makes the revolutionary change, the paradigm shift. These are a few aspects Kuhn notes on how these revolutions take place. He says a scientific revolution is a non-cumulative developmental episode in which an older paradigm is replaced in whole or in part by an incompatible new one. And I think that the traditional animal-based toxicology is about to be replaced. Because we are moving closer to having to make a choice between these fundamentally different approaches, something which is based on science and mechanism, or something which is based on these animals are substitutes for human beings. To the extent that two scientific schools disagree about what is a problem, what a solution, they will inevitably talk through each other when debating the relative merits of their respective paradigms. This is what we have been seeing. Yeah? I mean, there's a lot of discussion where the two schools are simply disagreeing. Since no two paradigms leave all the same problems unsolved, paradigm debates always involve the question, which problem is more significant to have solved? Exactly the type of discussion we are having. In the final analysis, this involves a question of values that lie outside of normal science altogether. So it's a lot of value. How safe do we want to be? How much can we obstruct things going to the market with precautionary approaches or not? He describes the process of how to replace a predecessor paradigm. At the beginning, it typically has few supporters. I recall when I moved into alternative methods some 30 years ago, we were very few, and people told me, how can you ruin your nice scientific career by moving into alternative methods? I will receive this week a very renowned award by the German Research Council, the same organization which was in the beginning not financing our work because it was considered not mainstream science. Yeah. If the supporters are competent, they will improve the paradigm, explore its possibilities, and show what it would be like to belong to the community guided by it. That's what took place over the last 20 years. For the paradigm destined to win, the number and strength of the persuasive arguments is in favor will increase, so more and more people joining are converted, exploration of the new technologies increases, the number of experiments, instruments, articles, books based on the paradigm will multiply, exactly what we have been observing. Our journals are flourishing. More scientists convinced of the new view's fruitfulness will adopt the new mode of practicing normal science, until only a few elderly holdouts will remain. And we cannot say that they are or were wrong. Perhaps the scientist who continues to resist after the whole profession has been converted, have ipso facto ceased to be a scientist. Okay, that's Thomas Kuhn. If you want to learn about what happened in these 12 years, this is an article of some of the opinion leaders about the progress done under the label of toxicity testing in the 21st century. Again, open line available. I lodged it also here with the QR code for those of you interested. There's enormous change in the way we do cell culture, which is spurring this. As I said, the tissue on chips, the human on chips developments. Here are two articles of stakeholder workshops we organized in the field. The latest one has just come out last week. Again, you can download it with the QR code or by asking me. If you want to learn more how this is impacting. And to show you that this has been finds now acceptance on highest level, this is Francis Collins. You know him as the director of NIH. These are two quotes of his, yeah? In 2011. He said, with earlier and more rigorous target validation in human tissues, it may be justifiable to skip the animal model assessment of efficacy altogether. Another one here from 2016, testimony to the subcommittee of Congress and of the Senate. He said, showing one of these human on chip models, I predict that 10 years from now, safety testing for newly developed drugs, as well as assessment of potential toxicity of numerous environmental exposures, will be largely carried out using human biochips and will mostly replace animal testing for drug toxicity and environmental sensing, giving results that are more accurate at lower cost and with higher throughput. So we have buy-in for these new technologies, new approaches now from top. And in September 2019, you may have seen that the EPA actually pledged to leave animal testing by 2035 altogether. And we're very pleased that in this context, we received a larger grant for our mini brain model, one of these advanced organ models. So the EPA is on track for this too. a lot of the revolution is about new technologies. Yeah, it's about big data, something we have not seen before. Omics, high content imaging, high throughput screening with robots, legacy data. So these are disruptive technologies which have come about in these 10 years. Artificial intelligence is one of them. You know, my involvement with frontiers in artificial intelligence, for example, but also our own work of 2 years ago, which was showing for the first time that machine learning, artificial intelligence on big data can actually outperform animal testing, and was nicely covered the same day in Nature and Science. So it was really getting a lot of interest by the scientific community. And only one testimonial here. This is Stefan Platz. He is the Senior Vice President of Clinical Pharmacology and Safety Science in AstraZeneca. And he commented on our work here and said, AI will not replace toxicologists, but those who don't use AI will be replaced by those who do. And I can tell you a traditional animal-based toxicologist does not use AI because you don't need AI for this. Our tool has been accepted on 1st of July in Australia. So since then, five of the hazards for chemicals, industrial chemicals, and also cosmetic ingredients in Australia can be assessed with the programs which are were part of our work, AI-based predictions, to show you that this is also moving forward. So to come to an end, I hope I have shown you that the revolution in toxicology is on the way. This is something positive. You know, Mark Kaur and myself, we are heading now the toxicology track, and I've accepted this obligation with the clear goal of revamping the toxicology education we are offering to the students in our field, because I think we have to reflect these dramatic changes which are taking place. We already do have some lectures which are offered to the students, one on toxicology in 21st century scientific applications, one on evidence-based toxicology in the third and fourth term. We have one on animal and research taught by Karen Herrmann. And Alex Mertens is offering the environmental genomics and epigenomic courses. Just to mention those my team is doing, but we have several others in the making, green toxicology for the R3 initiative. For doctoral students, we are doing practical ethics in biomedical sciences soon. And we are preparing for reproductive and developmental toxicology teaching. Lena is coordinating our education program. That's why her picture is here. But we also made our two flagship courses available online for free on Coursera. So it's not only you guys in Hopkins, you can take advantage. And you can see in less than 2 years, we had almost 5,000 active learners for the toxicology in the 21st century course, and almost 3,000 for the evidence-based toxicology class. And at the moment, we are adding almost 100 per course per week. Yeah. And we also prepare for an FDA certificate program together with Hopkins CERSI Center. So last slide. I think the scientific revolution is on the way. Poor Einstein has to serve here. But it's Max Planck who I chose as a critical quote at the end. Max Planck, actually, Thomas Kuhn did not agree with this statement, but Max Planck said very nicely, a new scientific truth does not triumph by convincing its opponents and making them see the light, but rather because its opponents eventually die and a new generation grow up that is familiar with it. It's a very cynical view on how science progresses, but at least we are trying to help with the new generation which grows up and is familiar with the new science. And that's what we hope to do with this lecture and many others to follow. Thank you very much. So, and I'm happy to take some questions from you guys.
So let me start off. You had talked about the last quote by Max Planck. I mean, that's really very powerful, I think. But I was wondering, in the case of toxicology, if another reason why there's so much resistance to change is because it's sort of embedded into all our regulations and our, at least in the US, in the risk assessment framework that EPA and others use. So it's people don't want to mess with it, you know? Is that,
yes.
Could you?
No, that's, in the US, we have a specific situation that it also needs to be legally defendable. That's a big, big issue here, because the EPA is permanently sued over any decision they are taking, and companies are being sued towards liability. So a paradigm shift is something which is very risky, both for the agencies and for the companies, because they're opening up vulnerabilities. How do they explain to the judge that they suddenly use a different approach? And how is it still, how can they make sure that this is even better protection? And what are the consequences then in retrospect for all the decisions taken on the old paradigm? Yeah. So you're losing a lot of innocence if you're showing that that the tools were not adequate for making decisions of the past. Yeah. And then which are consensus processes like the OECD, it can easily take 10 years to develop an OECD test guideline, because until the very last of the, I think, 34 countries which are part of the OECD process has agreed on each and every word of a guideline, it will not fly. Yeah, and this makes it very difficult to move these things forward quickly.
Another question from your, that's big slide where you have the different sort of bullet points from Thomas Kuhn's book about the precautionary principle. So.
And these were mine, they're my illustrations to his idea.
Yeah. Your list. Yeah. In the US, actually, the argument is usually that we should be moving to a more precautionary approach, whereas in the European Union, it's the other way around. And at least your slides seem to criticize that approach, the precautionary principle approach. Am I interpreting your message correctly?
I think the truth is as always between the two. Yeah. I come from the European perspective, having worked for the European Commission and implementing some of the precautionary work there. And to illustrate this, a lot of European legislation is based on hazard, not on risk. I think everybody knows a tiger is a hazard. A tiger in a cage is no risk because you're not exposed. Yeah? So very simple. But the precautionary would be, I don't go to the zoo because I don't know whether the tiger could not get free, which is ridiculous. We need to work that... we are not extreme in the precaution we take. The EU, for example, has decided that pesticides, which are endocrine disruptors in their standard tests, will have to be banned from the market, whether the concentration is relevant or not. This is likely killing about half of the pesticides on the market without necessarily representing a risk. So you see, if you overdo it, you force people into an exchange with sometimes substances which simply have not been tested as well. Regrettable substitutions, while we better would, let's say, manage the risk and be precautionary in the gray zone, yeah, where we cannot really judge or where we are close to having a risk. Yeah. But in 2008, I was still working for the European Commission, so precaution was for me one of the red flags, yeah, of things we are doing wrongly. Okay, 10, 9, 8.
Do others have any questions?
Does not seem to be the case. Okay, thank you very much for your interest and enduring the entire length of the presentation. As I said, the slides are available. There's been a recording. If you want to follow up on something, happy to send any of the papers cited or follow up in a personal discussion on any of the issues.
Thanks, yeah. Thomas.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Thanks, Thomas.
Bye-bye.